Nikola Tesla, another great radio inventor who invented wireless technology, has two of these stories himself. Tesla's invention of alternating current threatened Edison's empire of direct current. Edison even electrocuted an elephant with an alternating current to prove it was dangerous. She was called Topsy, and there's actually a video on the internet called Electrocuting an Elephant that Edison released where he zaps this beast. Tesla, second story. Tesla began a project in 1901 whose ultimate goal was to test the possibility of the supply of free energy the world over by wireless technology. He decided to build the Wardenclyffe Tower in Shoreham, Long Island for this experiment. When J.P. Morgan learned of the project's funding, project's aim for wireless technology in abundance, to the point of being free, he asked, how can we get money from electricity which Tesla is supplying to every part of the world? The project's funding was withdrawn, the tower was torn down, and is now a historical site. Tesla died broke and alone in the New Yorker hotel. Or perhaps you're Georg Cantor, a mathematician whose development of understanding of transfinite numbers makes him one of mathematics' big names today. His concept of different types of infinity was originally regarded as so counterintuitive, even shocking, that it encountered furious resistance from the mathematical contemporaries, while some Christian figures saw Cantor's work as a challenge to God. He was described as a scientific charlatan, a renegade, and even a corrupter of youth. Yet, any mathematician today must be familiar with at least some of set theory and transfinite mathematics, not all of them own toasters as well. A more striking example is that of Ignaz Semmelweis, a clinician in the first half of the 19th century. After observing a statistical correlation between hospital workers who had handled cadavers in the morgue and then immediately afterwards had delivered live babies and the incidence of often puerperal fever or childbed fever in those delivered babies, Semmelweis posited that washing one's hands after touching a dead body might be a wise thing. By introducing hand washing, Semmelweis lowered the incidence of contamination below 1%, yet he was derided, and medical textbooks debunking his position were published, and then used as establishment material to educate new medical students against his idea. In 1861, in his book, Semmelweis lamented the slow adoption of his ideas in the medical community, while deaths resulting from the non-adoption of his method, his proven method, continued. Most medical literature halls continue to resound with lectures on epidemic childbed fever and with discourses against my theories. The medical literature for the last 12 years continues to swell with reports of puerperal epidemics, and in 1854 in Vienna, the birthplace of my theory, 400 maternity patients died from childbed fever. In published medical works, my teachings are either ignored or attacked. The medical faculty at Würzburg awarded a prize to a monograph written in 1859 in which my teachings were rejected. It is perhaps no small irony that Semmelweis died in an insane asylum from septicemia, the very illness his discoveries would have helped cure. But Galileo and Armstrong are all part of a bygone era for us. Perhaps we can't relate because it's such a long time ago. Well, in the modern day, we have our own examples of this trend. This is Dr. Stanislaw Brzezinski, a Polish native doctor who practices in the States. A number of years ago, he discovered that individuals with cancer had very low amounts or a complete absence of certain heretofore undiscovered peptides in their blood and in their urine, theorizing that a reapplication of an isolated dose of these peptides might have an effect on tumors. He formed a treatment based on them and tested it. Remarkably, Brzezinski's theory proved right. Among other achievements are his first cures for normally incurable childhood brainstem cancer, which traditional treatments had never successfully cured. Thus, Brzezinski's patented non-toxic treatment is the first paradigm-changing cancer treatment with serious effectiveness, which is owned by a man, not a pharmaceutical company. He's a real guy. Go and look him up. It is then perhaps no small surprise, given what we saw in Armstrong, Tesla, Semmelweis, and so on, that Brzezinski, instead of being funded, enabled, and celebrated, was vilified as a pea doctor, a quack, and a fraud. He was taken to the Texas Supreme Court 6 times, despite the acknowledgement in the court that the treatment was non-toxic, and even with the admission that the trials weren't even about the effectiveness of the treatment. The National Cancer Institute finally ran their own controlled trials on his treatment, watering down his recommended dosages 200 times so they wouldn't work. Just imagine if the $5 billion that were thrown annually at the cancer industry were even fractionally made available to doctors like Brzezinski. In the intervening years, Brzezinski is still battling to have his cancer treatment accepted. Meanwhile, one can only reflect on the untold lives cut short, slowly and violently, while the FDA and the Texas Medical Board, the guardians of the status quo, do everything they can to limit the spreading of a treatment they cannot profit from and for which only Brzezinski holds the patent. American consumers spend $90 billion annually on cancer treatments. Brzezinski's case is unusual in that he is still alive. Ladies and gentlemen, this leads me to conclude that we do not live in an advanced society.